Well, folks, we're continuing in Ephesians this morning, and if you'll turn to page 1175 in your church Bible, 1175, we're in Ephesians chapter 4, and a shorter passage this morning, just verses 1 to 16 in Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4 from verse 1. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. I think we've got some echo on the system, Bob. If we can take that out, that'd be better for everybody, I think. From verse 3 again. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each part does its work. Well, please do keep your Bible open there. And let me pray. Heavenly Father, we are called into the body of our Lord Jesus Christ under his headship, and yet so often we take that for granted. Please challenge us this morning by your word, that we might change. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I was talking to my mate Dave McDonald the other day. Some of you have met Dave. He's, among other things, chaplain for the ACT Brumbies rugby team. I asked him about those constant newspaper stories you tend to get about young footy players who do stupid stuff and end up in trouble. I said to him, Dave, as chaplain, do you ever get to give them those famous pep talks about letting the club down, letting your mates down, letting your team down? And Dave said to me, you know, the funny thing is, they don't even need to be told. He said, they know it themselves. They know when they are not living in a way that's worthy of a member of the Brumbies. It's all, of course, in the end about who they think they are and whether or not they're going to live like it. And somehow my notes have been lost and I'll have to get a paper one. Well, it was going to be. Now, who they think they are and whether they're going to live with it, which is, you see, the exact issue we're tracking through in our Ephesians series, which the right slide is still up behind me, is called and has been every week, Who Do You Think You Are? And today's question is whether you, understanding that, are going to live in a way worthy of it as the people of God. Paul calls it in chapter 4, verse 1, did you notice, living in a way that is worthy of your calling, a calling to be part of the people of God. And it's all about how to be one people when we're made up of many, how to be united by the Spirit when all of us are so very different. I'm just going to have to do some rearrangements here too. Get the staple out. That's good. Get rid of that. And now we're good. Now, the last few weeks we've been digging down a level or two in this letter of Paul to the Ephesians and noticing back then that people like us who Paul calls the Gentiles, that we didn't have a hope when it comes to knowing the real God of the universe, that astonishingly to people like us, you see, he's actually saying only the Jews had it right, not because they were better, but because God had very purposefully revealed himself in their history and theirs alone, had chosen them as his people and them alone. Now their Messiah has come as ruler of all the nations. And the first Jewish Christian, and especially Paul, are opening up the doors to outsiders like us as well. The nations, which is the literal meaning of the word Gentiles. That means people like us. Which means, you see, we get to go from no hope to shared hope. From no inheritance, no future, to sharing theirs. From spiritual death to spiritual life as part of God's church are the great advertisement to the universe. Jewish Christians, Gentile Christians, all together as one. Now, that's the theory. That's Paul's prayer for them. That's a sum up, if you haven't been here, of the last 3 weeks of Ephesians. Now here in chapter 4, Paul is saying, if you get it, then it's time to live in a way that's worthy of it. That's the theory. Now here's the practical. Chapter 4, verse 1 again, as a prisoner for the Lord then, says Paul, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. In fact, literally, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling that has gathered you together. There's a word play here in the original because the idea of calling a meeting together is at the heart of the actual word for church, ecclesia, which literally means a calling together, a gathering of all kinds of people under the one Lord Jesus Christ. So what is that going to look like in practice? Well, it is, in fact, surprisingly simple. There are some pointers. They're crystallised in verses 2 and 3, and then they're expanded. And at every point, it's about how very diverse people express and strengthen our unity as we realise we're all part of one body but with different parts to play, which is going to, in the end, boil down to very practical things. Verse 2, attitude things like being completely humble and gentle. Not humble just sometimes and gentle every now and then, depending on the circumstances, but completely, especially when it's hard, and especially when you obviously know best and the other person doesn't. How are you going to go at being humble and gentle then? Be patient, says Paul. These things are so straightforward. Bearing with one another in love. This is worthy living. This is what it's going to look like. Bearing with each other, of course, obviously, it means putting up with each other at the times you don't feel like it. Not just the times that it's easy, but the times when it's tough. And verse 3, which you'll notice assumes there is already an underlying unity from God's Spirit, but reminds us that sometimes preserving that unity can be hard work. Because it can so easily slip through our fingers. Make every effort, says Paul, to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Because, you see, there is nothing more unworthy of our calling than to let unity slip through our fingers. Kim mentioned it a couple of weeks ago, you might remember. Make every effort. It means it's It's hard and not easy. It means if you feel ready to give up, give it one more go. See, the logic is simple, verses 4 to 6. The reason we're meant to make every effort to stay united is that we are part of that one body, sparked and animated and brought to life by one Spirit. Verse 12, if you run your eye through the passage, the body is a theme in our passage this morning. He's talking about the body again in verse 12. The whole goal, he says, is that the body of Christ may be built up, the whole church growing and stronger, more mature towards it. Again, he says unity in the faith. Verse 15, we're growing, he says, it's the body again, growing to become in every respect the mature body of Christ the head. And from him, verse 16, the body again, the whole body grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. This whole passage is all about being that growing, maturing, strengthening body. And look, it is all very current, isn't it? Because for the past few years, we've been trying to work through the question of how do we keep growing the body here at MPC? How do we keep growing and uniting and maturing the body? If you look back at a photo from Jeff Cowles of what it looked like 17 years ago, you'll see we've grown as a body in all kinds of ways. Though, thankfully, the guy up the front, if you look closely, might have shrunk a few sizes since then. But our goal has been growing followers of Jesus. And we've planted and we've started new congregations and we've worked out how to grow in different age groups. And as we built the original building 90 years ago and then replaced it in the 60s so we could grow and extended it 2003 so we could grow some more, we've kept following that theme, growing the body. But of course the growth itself comes from and comes among the people, growing in love, growing in unity. And if we don't have that, we don't have anything. And up to this point, we've maintained it. Because according to Paul, as he's welding together this Ephesian church made up of Gentiles and Jews, such different people, the people he'll call in the original language the saints of the old days, and then this new group of Gentile converts with no backstory at all, he's reminding them over and over again that they are called to be one. And they've got to throw everything they've got into being that one. Because you see, no matter what direction you've come from to here, God's same Spirit is working in you and working in me, and there is a family bond as the same Spirit works at transforming our differences in the one direction of being like Jesus. You'll see the word one jumping out of the passage seven times. If you just look back up the page and run your eye down from verse 4 to 6. Paul says, hold on to your unity because, you see, there is just one body and one Spirit. And you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord. There's one faith. There's one baptism. There's one God and Father of all who's over all and through all and in all. No matter who you are in the church, no matter what your background, all of us come under those same seven ones, which means we are one. In Paul's gospel mathematics, seven times one equals one. You and I, same Lord. It's interesting, I don't know if you've met our friend Kayoko from Japan. She's been visiting the last few weeks, usually at the second service, and you might see her coming as you leave. She's part of a church in Osaka. Lou and I visited there a few years ago. Kayoko doesn't have very much English. We don't have any Japanese at all. Her daughter was an exchange student with us years ago. But as we went along to church with her at her church in Osaka, it was very, very obvious. We all share the one Lord Jesus. I really hope she's finding that as she visits us here. We all share the one baptism, the one God, the one Spirit, the same one hope. Seven out of seven. how much more obvious should that be week by week to all of us in our church family here, in our day-by-day and our week-by-week relationships? Because Paul moves seamlessly, doesn't he, from these grand ideas of theology to simple things like our humility, our gentleness, our patience, the way you will put up with someone who's a little bit difficult, the way you'll flex into doing new things, living in a way that's worthy of the calling we've received to be one united church. So I do wonder, are you protective of the unity of our church family? Are you watching out for the sort of words and actions that cause division? It's obvious when you spot it, isn't it? A sharp comment here. Sort of remark when someone draws you aside, you know they're just fishing for opportunities to fan up discontent. Don't listen. Be wise enough to look for ways to do the exact opposite. I mean, here is a new thought. Why not draw someone aside and quietly say something positive in a way that promotes unity? But look, it's even more than that, because as a body, as a church, Paul says we are meant to be exercising and growing in the way we serve one another. That's the point he makes in verse 7 to 16, a section that starts and finishes with a reference to the different part each of us is given in the body. We will all serve, but all in a different way. First of all, verse 7, pick up there. The church is one body with one spirit, but to each of us, verse 7, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. To each of us, a different gift, a different part to play. The starting point, the way Paul pictures it in verse 8, it's like the risen Jesus is a victorious general who's brought home all kinds of treasures from the battle he's been fighting. He's been down there to the lower places of earth. He's come back in victory to heaven. And now he pours out by his Spirit all kinds of gifts to his people in victory. Hey guys, I won! But not have some gold, have some spices, have some sheep and cattle from the victory. It's here. Let's start with some apostles. I'll give you those. Have some prophets to get you ready. They're what the church was built on. That's what Paul says in the previous chapter. Have some gifted evangelists who'll help you spread the word. Have some pastor teachers. You'll love those. All of them, verse 11, he says, God's gifts to his church. All of them, he says, to prepare the first Christians to reach the rest, and then for them to reach and grow more. Now, if you're the technical type and you like drilling down to the details, if you're not, you can switch off for just a moment. But in the older translations, you can see in verse 12, Paul uses the saints' word again, which with New Testament experts like Donald Robinson, I'm suggesting was originally the word for the first Jewish Christians in the church. And you see the prophets and the apostles at first built them up with a single purpose. Don't know if you realise this, but Paul, who's writing this letter, you see, he is the only one of all the apostles who went to the Gentiles like us. The other guys, like Peter and James and John, totally focused on the first Jewish Christians. And there were lots of first Jewish Christians. But Paul's point is, you see, all of them, they should be doing that with the same one intention, of building up the one church that includes everyone. Those first apostles, like the prophets before them, their whole goal is to prepare those original saints for works of service so that, in verse 12, the whole body of Christ might be built up. It wasn't for them, it was for us, until we all reach unity in the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole fullness of Christ. Here is the logic, and friends, I want to challenge you, it needs to be the same principle now, that those who are there first are always there for the ones to be included next. That's how the body grows. If you were a first Jewish Christian, and this was confronting to them, the whole point of it was to include non-Jews like us. that the old are there to build in the new. Which thankfully, though it took them a while to get used to the idea, thankfully they ultimately did. And then, of course, the new get to work using our gifts for the newer still. You see, it's ultimately every body part has a job to do. Verse 16, as the section closes, from him, from the Lord Jesus, the whole body joined and held together by every supporting ligament grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Ligaments of love, all pulling together, holding together, growing the body. One body with many parts, all doing a bit. One Lord, but he's handed out loads of gifts to each one of us to build up his body. Paul says grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. I'm not sure if you've ever been called a ligament before. That's what we are, pulling together, holding together, growing together. Body, all of us serving in our own separate ways. You know, there is an astonishing statistic about MPC. I was shocked when I saw it. You might actually notice or get the feeling that as a body we're not particularly well coordinated sometimes. Sometimes we bump into things, trip over. But the fact is there are over 400 MPC body members on different rosters or signed on to help in different ways. Countless different ways, willing to help with emergency meals. A bunch more parents, as Pete said, signing up to help with kids ministry a couple of weeks ago, and now we're asking for non-parents as well, because that is a huge task. Musicians who just want to serve, rehearsing on a Wednesday or a Saturday, just so they can serve us better here on a Sunday morning. The guys I call the secret service. They come in midweek and mow the lawns and fix stuff without ever being on a roster or ever being noticed, not even on a list. People who are teaching the Bible in all different kinds of contexts, like growth group leaders, wow. The challenge, of course, is with numbers like that, keeping the right people doing the right things at the right times in the right places, and that in itself is a huge job for the people in the background making it happen. We've mentioned already, a couple of weeks' time, we're celebrating the 90th anniversary of MPC. A happy crew 90 years ago, who at every key point in their history kept looking to the next generation and inviting people in. In that long chain from them going all the way back to those original saints who were prepared for service by the apostles and the prophets and served and grew and built up the body, which grows stronger and stronger as each part does its work. You might be thinking you can just be part of a church to take, to spectate. Paul says, if that's what you think church is, you'll actually never experience real church at all. Because real church is being part of a living, growing, loving, serving body, growing as each part does its work. You know, anyone who's ever played in an orchestra will tell you that it is way more fun playing in an orchestra than just listening to it. With church, we've all got a part to play. Whatever. Maybe your part is just to say the right word at the right time, a unifying, encouraging word. Like playing the triangle, just the right ding at the right time makes all the difference. Maybe it's to pray. Maybe it is a brand new role in kids' ministry. Because you see, we're all meant to have the same goal of encouraging one another to grow to maturity, to be more and more like Jesus, our head. Now, of course, the other alternative to growing up is to just keep being a baby. And verse 14 paints a very vivid little word picture of, it's disturbing, really, of a bunch of babies in a storm in a boat being tossed around. If we're built up by the pastor teachers who are building on the words of the apostles and the prophets, if each part is doing its work, then we will no longer be infants, verse 14, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Now, I'm not sure what the latest wave is right at the moment, the latest Christian trend that's not actually Christian at all. In the old days, you'd usually spot it first in the Koorong book catalogue, the Christian bookstore, because there would always be a new Christian thing, something on the market, this new blessing or that new blessing, this special prayer that you could pray every day and you'd be guaranteed to increase your boundaries as long as you prayed the right words the right way at the right times. Well, the author increased his boundaries anyway. It sold like hotcakes. Now, maybe there are people who reckon because we believe in a resurrection that we'll believe anything at all. And it seems some will. But Paul says the best protection against those sort of Christian scams, the best way to avoid being blown around by every new wave, is just to grow up. And the best way to grow up is to be part of a body where we speak the truth to one another in love. So we will in all things grow up, verse 15, into him who is the head. Loving words designed to grow us to be more like Jesus. Supporting one another. Building one another up in love as each part does its work. So, who do you think you are? Do you reckon you could be part of a church like that? Church that's full of humble and gentle and patient people who put up with one another. More than that, who love each other. Wonder what part you can play to make our church more and more like that for someone else, the next person who's new, for the next generation. I wonder what you'd need to be doing different to be living more and more a life worthy of that calling we've received. Verse 2 says we're meant to be a people who bear with one another in love. Verse 15 says we're meant to speak the truth to one another in love. Verse 16 says we're meant to be a body that grows and builds itself up in love. Maybe that's the challenge for you. Maybe you realise there's someone here today that you need to forgive and forbear with so you can grow together. Maybe you need to learn to be gentle. Maybe you need to work on your humility so that you don't always need to be the one who's right, be the one who wins. Maybe there is someone you need to speak the truth to in love. For all of us, it's going to be about living lives worthy of the great calling we have received. Which isn't, by the way, as I finish, isn't in the way you might have come to understand those words of your calling. To primarily be living out your calling to be a doctor, or living out your calling to be a policeman, or living out your calling to be a cleaner, though not many people seem to have been called to that in the past. But living out your calling to be part of the body of Christ, the great gathered and growing church of God himself. Gary's going to lead us in prayer.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you, the Holy God, creator of all things, have called us, unworthy as we are, to be both your adopted children and ambassadors for your kingdom. We pray, Father, that though you call us in unworthiness, you are at work in us through the Spirit of Jesus to make us more like him. We thank you, Lord, that you gift each one of us and you bind us together so that as we exercise our gifts together, this body, that is your church here at MPC, grows stronger and more effective in ministering to the community around us, whether their needs are physical or spiritual. Father, we pray that just as we care for our own body, you would help us to be committed to caring for this body, to discover who we are as part of this body, to discover our gifts and to exercise them with enthusiasm for the good of all. Help us to rejoice in the gift of others and to encourage them and guide them with sensitivity and love, that they might not lose heart but will continue to serve with joy. Help us as individuals and as one body to speak the truth in love and with humility, striving always to be servants of the gospel. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.